Hallelujah, hallelujah. The Word became flesh and pitched his tent among us, and we have seen his glory. Hallelujah. We gather in the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
It's such a joy to be with you here at St. James this morning, my new home. Hurrah! And with that, my voice has gone. Oh! So ignore me as I kind of struggle through a head cold today. I may not do the singing bits today, sorry. I'm really looking forward to it though, once the voice has recovered. And I do hope after the service you can join us in the parish centre for a bit of Prosecco and a bit more celebration, which will be great. Let us pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Today is the festival of the presentation of Christ in the temple, known as Candlemas. And I think you've all got some little blue candles there. So if you'd like to hold them up. We haven't, but that's okay. Hold them up because they're for you to take home with you. But hold them up now and we'll pray for God's blessing on those. Lord Jesus, we thank you that you are the light of the world, and we pray for your blessing to rest upon us who bear these candles, that they may shine as lights in our lives to the glory of God the Father. Amen. Hear the words of our Saviour Jesus Christ. I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me shall never walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. Let us therefore bring our sins into his light and confess them in penitence and faith. Almighty God, hear now the words of grace. Your sins are forgiven in the name of the living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
collect and Bible readings for the Feast of Candlemas. Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, clothed in majesty, whose beloved Son was this day presented in the temple, in substance of our flesh, grant that we may be presented to you with pure and clean hearts by your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please do be seated.
A reading from Hebrews chapter 2, verses 14 to the end. Since, therefore, the children share flesh and blood, he himself likewise shared the same things, so that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is, the devil, and free those who all their lives were held in slavery by the fear of death. For it is clear that he did not come to help angels, but the descendants of Abraham. Therefore, he had to become like his brothers and sisters in every respect, so that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God, to make a sacrifice of atonement for the sins of the people. Because he himself was tested by what he suffered, he is able to help those who are being tested. This is the word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you. Hear now the Holy Gospel of our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord God.
When the time came for their purification according to the law of Moses, Mary and Joseph brought Jesus up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male shall be designated as holy to the Lord. And they offered a sacrifice, according to what is stated in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, looking forward to the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit rested on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. Guided by the Spirit, Simeon came into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what was customary under the law, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Master, now you are dismissing your servant in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." And the child's father and mother were amazed at what was being said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to his mother Mary, "This child is destined for the falling and the rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be opposed, so that the inner thoughts of many will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophet, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was of a great age, having lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage. Then, as a widow to the age of 84, she never left the temple, but worshipped there with fasting and prayer, night and day. At that moment, she came and began to praise God and to speak about the child to all who were looking for the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had finished everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. This is the Gospel of Christ.
May I speak in the name of the living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Please do be seated. It's such a joy to be here today on this great feast day of the Holy Family's visit to Jerusalem and the presentation of Christ in the temple, just 40 days after his birth in Bethlehem. And I tell you what, I have never been as busy and as fraught between Christmas and Epiphany and then Candlemas. It's been so mad. Those 40 days have gone very quickly indeed. Even outside of major festivals, Jerusalem was a busy spiritual destination for pilgrimage. With the Holy Temple and its various courts a hive of activity and noise, people coming and people going, political intrigue and social joys and celebrations, parties too. In line with tradition, each day families would present their firstborn male, and there would have been many women undergoing ritual purification. Thankfully, it's another world away. But if you've ever been on pilgrimage, perhaps to the Holy Land or even Walsingham in Norfolk, you can imagine the atmosphere. I fondly recall some of the pilgrimages I've been on, not least to Walsingham, where there's a heady mix of glorious worship and wonderful socialising in the Bull, the pub on the corner opposite. I probably remember more of that than anything else. Sorry, it's true. It's a good thing I remember. Think about it. Now, you're probably familiar with the hymn, Dear Lord and Father of Mankind, which is often chosen for Christian funerals, the tune of which is used at Walsingham for the departing hymn. It's so evocative and beautiful. But what you may not know is that the words of Dear Lord and Father of Mankind are actually taken from a longer poem by an American poet, John Greenleaf Whittier, entitled, bear with me, The Brewing of Soma. Oh, you wait. With the first section in stark contrast to the latter. It begins, hold on to your seats. You will not believe it, really. The faggots blazed, the cauldron smoke up, through the green wood curled. Bring honey from the hollow oak. Bring milky sap, the brewers spoke, in the childhood of the world. Oh, and it gets worse, because what he's describing is a sort of pilgrimage of sorts of Vedic priests taking part in a primeval ritual gathered around a blazing fire as they prepare the soma, the drink, a ritual drink back to proto-Indo-Iranian times. and this drink had hallucinogenic properties. I know, people of Weybridge, can you imagine? A bit like the Prosecco we're going to drink in a moment in the parish centre, perhaps. And there were places around the great temple in Jerusalem and its surrounds that have probably felt a bit like that in the time that the Holy Family were there. Quite in contrast, one should add, to the stillness of a Quaker meeting home with which John Whittier was more familiar. Because that's what his poem does. It contrasts, on the one hand, the extremes of people's behaviour with God's stillness and presence and warmth, love and reassurance. Now, the temple was a place of structured worship. We call that liturgy today, don't we, in church? Amid all the hustle and bustle, Mary and Joseph and Jesus would have looked like another ordinary family going about their business, and Jesus would have looked like another ordinary little boy. Yet, in all the busyness, the throng, the noise, the people, the smells, and so much more, Simeon and Anna recognize the extraordinary. With all that stuff going on in the distance, they see through the crowds and they recognize the incarnate, that God has chosen to dwell among people in human flesh, and they had the absolute joy and privilege of meeting that presence. And they'd waited. And they'd waited and waited and waited for that day when Christ would be there among them. So friends, I'm new here. I'm always reminded of walking into a church in my Cambridge days and somebody saying, "Are you new here?" in a very Cambridge sounding voice, to which I said, no, I'm about 28 years old. But I am the new guy. And that means I don't know what your rituals and traditions and practices and habits are. So I want to say from the outset, don't let anything I do offend you, because I don't know if it isn't what you're used to doing. Tell me. Share your thoughts with me. Talk to me. Tell me about the things that matter to you as Christians. And I'll tell you what matters to me. Because when we look at Simeon and Anna and their faithfulness, well, I can look around this congregation and think of people here who already, I know, display that same sense of commitment and faithfulness in the life of our temple, this church community, this building which faces east to the great temple in Jerusalem. Our spirits lifted to see the very presence of Christ who reaches out to us in love from the altar, who reaches out to us and meets us just like that baby, but in the form of bread and wine. Friends, what matters is that our worship enables us to speak and listen to God, and that we have the patience to wait upon the Lord while always seeking to be in his presence. But being a church family means we're on a journey back to the pilgrimage. And when you go on a journey, you don't end up in the same place that you started inside. You're changed by the journey. Now, what's fascinating about churches advertising for a vicar, I know because I preached on this, you might remember, just over a year ago, is that you ask for certain things. I suspect you've got a lot of what you asked for. But that isn't always what you really want. Do you know what I mean? And it almost always isn't what you always need. So we're going to journey together. A few people in the last few days have said, "Oh, I'm a bit worried about change." And I've said, "Don't be worried about change, because I will change and you will change and they will change. We will change together. We will evolve and grow and renew. and we will grow, and we will renew, but it will happen over time. So those of you expecting me to come in with a big bang, I've nearly lost my voice, sorry, it's not going to be quite like that. And on the other hand, those who think it's going to be always exactly what it is now, it can't be, because we've got to recover from COVID and rediscover what it is to be a parish church. Does that make sense? And we're going to do that together. We're going to pilgrimage together. And I'm asking you to be faithful in that, like Simeon and Anna. And I know we're resourced in that journey here at the altar, where the very real presence of Christ feeds us, meets us, encounters us, whoever we are, whatever we bring, and changes us. We're on a journey. And then when I thought about this more, I thought, well, the last verse of that wonderful hymn, Dear Lord and Father of Mankind, is so comforting. I think it's why we often use it at funerals, actually. And I'm not saying today my first Sunday is like a funeral, please, no. But funerals are a marker of change. And today is a day for recognizing there is a change here in this community. Our priorities as church are to sing, to worship God, to offer the very best of who we are, and to gather around the altar and to do what Jesus commanded us to do, to break the bread. Do this. But to do that, we need to be faithful, like Simeon and Anna. So listen to Whittier's words of comfort and reassurance in the face of change. Breathe through the heats of our desires, thy coolness and thy balm. Let sense be dumb, let flesh retire, speak through the earthquake, wind and fire. O still small voice of calm, the Christ child, a mere baby, spoke with God's presence to Simeon and Anna. A still voice of calm. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We stand to declare our faith in God in the words of the Family Creed from Ephesians chapter 3. We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, Let us pray for the church and for the world, and thank God for his goodness.
Heavenly Father, on 2nd February we celebrate Candlemas, which marks the conclusion of Christmas and Epiphany, and, as we've heard this morning, the day when Mary and Joseph presented baby Jesus to the temple in Jerusalem. As the Messiah was revealed to Simeon, so inspire us to bring this revelation to others, that they too might believe. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving God, the annual Week of Prayer for Christian Unity has just finished. With worldwide persecution, it is more important than ever that churches work towards being united, not divided. Father, please help us in our own communities to learn how to differ well and to spread harmony, peace, and love. Lord, in your mercy. Hear our prayer. All-powerful God, in these unstable times, we pray that your justice and mercy will guide the hearts, minds, and actions of officers in authority, that they do not abuse their power. We pray that horrors such as the Holocaust will never again be experienced. May political and faith leaders at home and throughout the world be generously endowed with your wisdom and compassion. We also pray that you will inspire and lead our own King Charles III to tread a wise and sensitive path. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, we earnestly pray that you will sustain your people who are suffering from man-made conflicts and bring peace to their countries. May the beauty and design of your creation be properly appreciated and the damage that we have caused be effectively addressed, bringing our world closer to your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, may we constantly be thankful for the many blessings we have. Remembering the prayer attributed to St. Francis of Assisi, "For it is in giving that we receive," we ask you to inspire us to share our resources with those in need, whether at home or abroad, and to use whatever skills we have to serve others in our community. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we thank you for bringing Father Damian to lead this parish forward, and we pray that St. Mary's Church at Thorpe will soon have a new vicar in place. We also pray that Louise, who has looked after us so well during the past very trying times, will, in good time, find out where her adventurous change will take her and her supportive family. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Compassionate and loving Father, may your love and peace be with those known to us, or known only to you, who are suffering from illness or from loss, and may your strength and comfort sustain them. We ask that your blessing be upon those who have recently departed this life: Ivy Crafter, Dennis Cates, Vivian Edwicker, Peter Certin, and in the year's mind, Joe Sharp, John Hales, Albert Jenkins, Ina Parr, Janet Rubidge, Alan Forsyth, Anthony Purefoy, William Taylor. May light perpetual shine upon them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Faithful and loving God, please help us to support each other on our journey of faith by following the example of Jesus, your word made flesh. Taking a line from St. Richard of Chichester's prayer, may we know you more clearly, love you more dearly, and follow you more nearly, day by day. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
What really lovely intercessions, thank you. Let's stand for the peace. In the tender mercy of our God, the day spring from on high has broken upon us to give light to those who dwell in darkness and in the shadow of death, and to guide our feet into the way of peace. And the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have this wine to set before you, fruit of the vine and work of human hands. It will become for us the cup of salvation. Lord, accept our gifts on this joyful feast of our salvation. By our communion, may we become more like Jesus, who joins our lives to yours, for he is Lord forever and ever. Amen. Okay. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and good always and everywhere to give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ, who is one with you from all eternity. For on this day he appeared in the temple in substance of our flesh to come near to us in judgment. He searches the hearts of all your people and brings to light the image of your splendor. Your servant Simeon acclaimed him as the light to lighten the nations, while Anna spoke of him to all who looked for your redemption. Destined for the falling and rising of many, he was lifted high upon the cross. And a sword of sorrow pierced his mother's heart when by his sacrifice he made our peace with you. Therefore, with all the angels of heaven, we lift our voices to proclaim the glory of your name and sing our joyful hymn of praise. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Jesus is Lord. Lord, by your cross and resurrection, you have set us free. You are the Saviour of the world. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. As we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, we bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people, gathering to one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we, in the company of our Blessed Lady Mary, the Virgin Mother of God, St. James, Joseph, and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, for ever and ever. Amen. Let us pray with confidence, as our Saviour has taught us. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. God's holy gifts for God's holy people. Jesus Christ is holy. Jesus Christ is Lord. To the glory of God the Father.
Let us pray. Lord, you fulfilled the hope of Simeon and Anna, who lived to welcome the Messiah. May we who have received these gifts beyond words prepare to meet Christ Jesus when he comes to bring us to eternal life. For he is alive and reigns now and forever. Amen. We say together the third of the printed prayers. God of glory, you nourish us with your word, which is the bread of life. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, that through us the light of your glory may shine in all the world. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Oh, how exciting. I get to do notices properly for the first time. And we're not infested with flies. Yay. I'm not sure Bishop Andrew appreciated my jokes, but hey, never mind. Bless him. He did ever so well, didn't he? And I think we should thank everyone who helped make Thursday just tremendous. Should we give them all a round of applause? You have all the general notices there and, of course, the newsletters sent out as well, which you've received. And there's lots on there, but in particular, I want to highlight the Friends of St. James Church quiz and supper night, which is Saturday, March the 4th, in the parish centre from 7 p.m. to 7:30. There's a cash bar. Ooh. And a raffle. Cool, we're pushing the boat out, aren't we? Tickets just 15, that's very reasonable for Weybridge, £15. I can't seem to walk into anywhere to buy food without it being 20 or 25. So that's very reasonable evening out. So I'll see everyone there, will I? Yeah. Yes, it will be good. I have to say I'm a bit competitive about quizzes. Jason and I, well, Jason in particular loves only Connect. Can you answer those questions? Do you know the one I mean? They're balmy, aren't they? I'm sure it won't be that level of quizzing, but nonetheless, maybe we'll get an Only Connect team together from St. James, shall we? That would be something, wouldn't it? But yeah, please do come and take part in that. Church wardens, do you have any notices today? Gardening group, 9 o'clock on Saturday. Yes, indeed. Thank you very much. And PCC, looking forward to being with you tomorrow evening at 7:30, when hopefully I have more voice, not less. Although this kind of deep, gravelly voice is quite attractive. I don't think I'll hold on to it, but never mind. Any other notices? Sunday school, yes, you're next. What have you been doing? You going to come and show us? Oh, let's see if I can mic you up and do my DJ thing. There you go. All right.
Today we talked about a wedding that Jesus went to.
The wine ran out and Jesus did a miracle.
At the wedding
in Galilee, Jesus turned water into wine. It was his first miracle.
Thank you. But was it any old wine? Not like the stuff I talked about in my sermon. It sounds horrid, doesn't it? This was the finest, best wine. And they said, why have you saved? Normally, they, you know, you save that till everyone's drunk and then, you know. But no, the very best wine Jesus offers us, and he offers us that best wine in our lives too. Thank you. Give them a round of applause. Now, if you're at a loose end on a Wednesday, we'd love to see you at communion in church 10 o'clock this Wednesday. Louise and I will be here. And it would be a joy to see you for that. And we're hoping soon to be able to introduce refreshments afterwards. Oh, I know. How exciting would that be? Let's stand to pray for God's blessing. The Lord be with you. Christ, the Son of God, born of Mary, fill you with his grace to trust his promises and obey his will. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, Amen.